If there is any mishap at the MC tonight, if Miss Doolittle suffers any embarrassment whatsoever, it'll be on your hands alone.
Eliza can do anything. I know Eliza can do anything.
Suppose she is discovered. Remember what happened at Ascot? Suppose she makes another ghastly mistake.
There'll be no horse to the ball, Pickering.
This is no time for flippancy, Higgins. The way you've driven the girl the last 6 weeks has exceeded all bounds of common decency. For God's sake, stop pacing up and down. Can't you set it somewhere?
Have some tea. It'll quieten your nose.
I'm not nervous. Where is it?
On the table.
The car is here, sir.
Oh, good. Tell Miss Doolittle.
Yes, sir. Tell Miss Doolittle, indeed. Are you so sure this girl will retain everything you've hammered into her?
Well, we shall see.
Suppose she doesn't.
I lose my bet.
Higgins, there is one thing I cannot stand about you, and that is your confounded complacency. And what about the girl? You act as though she doesn't matter at all.
Oh, rubbish, Pickering. Of course she matters. What do you think I've been doing all these months? What could possibly matter more than to take a human being and change her into a completely different human being by creating a new speech for her? It's filling up the deepest gaps that separate soul from soul and class from class. No, she matters immensely.
I saw Miss Doolittle. She looked beautiful. Did you see her?
I did. Not bad. Not bad at all.
Mr. and Mrs. Hugh Duval, Major General and the Right Honourable Sir James Clarence, Marquis and Marquise of Glenning, Zoltan Carpathy, Lady Susanna de Longley, Sir Albert and Lady Dering, the Honourable Mr. Archibald and Lady Catherine Herring.
Maestro, maestro, don't remember me?
No, who the devil are you?
I'm your pupil, your first pupil. I'm Zoltan Carpathy, that marvelous boy.
Oh.
I made your name famous throughout Europe. You teach me phonetics. You cannot forget me, maestro.
Why don't you have your hair cut?
You like my hair. If I had my hair cut, nobody would notice me.
What all these old coins?
Oh, these. These are decorations for language. The Queen of Transylvania is here this evening. I'm indispensable to her at these official international parties. I speak 32 languages. I know everyone in Europe. No imposter can escape my detection.
Professor Carpathy, such a pleasure to see you here.
The Greek ambassador. Greek my foot. She pretends not to know any English, but she cannot deceive me. She speaks English so villainously. I help her pretend. I make them all all pay through the nose.
Excuse me, sir. You were wanted upstairs. Her Excellency asked for you.
Oh, excuse me.
The Viscount and Viscountess Saxon, the Baron and Baroness of Yorkshire, Sir Guy and Lady Scott Ackland, the Count and Countess Demiru, Viscount and Viscountess Hillier, Mr. and Mrs. Richard Lancer, Lord and Lady Clanders, Colonel Pickering.
Good evening, kind attention parents. A scooty MH03BL8935. I repeat, MH03BL8935 is parked at a wrong place. It is creating a trouble at the resident for the residents in the vicinity. Parents are requested to please park their vehicles correctly so that we can proceed with the program. Thank you.
A garden?
So she has. A sort of garden.
Nice. young lady with Colonel Pickering. Find out who she is.
It will be my pleasure, madam.
Higgins, just a moment. You must take Liza home at once. There's a language expert here. We'll get caught. I beg your pardon. The whole situation is highly explosive.
Sultan, tell me some more about the Greek ambassador.
Gladly, but first I would love you to introduce me to this glorious beauty.
Does she really come from Yorkshire?
Her Majesty, the Queen of Transylvania, and His Royal Highness, Prince Gregor.
Lady Catherine Herring, Miss Ainsford Hill, Mr. Freddie Hill, Lord Boxington, Professor Karpathy, Professor Henry Higgins, Colonel Pickering, Miss Eliza Doolittle.
Charming, quite charming.
Mother, I would like to dance with her.
Miss Doolittle, my son would like to dance with you.
I dance with you.
She's a princess.
Oh, Pickering. They all think Eliza is a princess. No one realizes she's a flower girl. Absolutely fantastic.
A lot of tomfoolery.
It was an immense achievement.
Well, Mr. Higgins?
A triumph, Mrs. Pierce. A total triumph. Higgins, you were superb. Absolutely superb. Tell us the truth now. Were you a bit nervous once or twice?
Oh, not for a second.
Not during the whole evening?
I saw we were doing hands down.
I felt like a bear trapped in a cage, hanging about with nothing to do.
It was an immense achievement.
A lot of talk.
Absolutely fantastic. Higgins, I salute you.
I'm taking the seat.
Number 54. House with the bamboo door. Bamboo roof and bamboo walls. Baby, got a bamboo floor. You must get to know. So, oh, Joe. Run to the espresso. Oh, the house of bamboo. It's a made of sticks. Sticks and bricks.
Really nothing.
All alone you hold every obstacle in sight.
Now wait. Give credit where it's due. A lot of the glory goes to you.
But you're the one who did it. There's no doubt about it. You did it.
Shortly after we came in, I saw it once. We'd easily win.
You should have heard the oohs and ahs. Everyone wondering who she was.
You'd think they'd never seen a lady before.
And when the Prince of Transylvania gave his arm to lead her to the floor, I said to him, you did it. You did it. You did it. There's no doubt about it. You did it.
Well, thank goodness for Sultan Karpathy. If it hadn't been for him, I would have died of boredom.
Karpathy, the dreadful Hungarian? Was he there?
Yes, he was there. All right and up to his old tricks. He uses the science of speech more to swindle and blackmail than teach. He made it his business of his to find out who this Miss Doolittle is. Every time he turned around, there he was. So I let him dance with her. And when at last the dance was done, he announced to the hostess that she was a fraud.
No!
Her English is too good, he said. He said she's a born Hungarian. Not only Hungarian, but of royal blood.
Oh!
Royalty's absolutely written on her face. Can you believe Karpathy said she's not only Hungarian, but as Hungarian as the first Hungarian rhapsody. Well, thank goodness that's over. Now I can go to bed without dreading tomorrow.
Good night, Mr. Higgins.
Good night, Mrs. Pierce.
Higgins, I think I'll turn in too. It's been a great occasion. Good night.
Good night, Pickering. Oh, Mrs. Pierce. Ah, damn. I meant to ask her to give me coffee in the morning instead of tea. Leave a little note for her, will you, Eliza? And turn out the lights.
Oh, you are an insensitive brute. Go away. I don't want to be here. I will go back to my people, my streets, my flowers, and my father. Buy a flower, miss, would you?
Yes, please.
Good morning, miss. Could I help you?
Do you mind if I warm my hands?
Go right ahead, miss.
Excuse me, miss.
Yes?
For a second, I thought you were somebody else.
Who?
Extremely sorry, ma'am. Early morning lights playing tricks with my eyes.
Could I get you a taxi, ma'am? A lady like you shouldn't be walking alone around London this hour in the morning.
No, thank you.
Such a charming spot this, Harry. We must visit this place more often.
Father?
Oh, no. You see, Harry, Mr. Higgins has no mercy. He sent me, daughter, my own flesh and blood, to spy on me in this my misery. Go tell Mr. Higgins that straight. I'm miserable.
What are you talking about, Father? And what are you dressed up for?
As if you didn't know. Go back to that house number 54 Wimble Street, devil, and tell him what he's done to me.
What's Mr. Higgins done to you?
Ruined me, that's all. Changed me into a middle-class bugger. That's what he's done to me. Now, I have to worry about morals. Don't you defend him, my girl. Mr. Alfred P. Doolittle, common dustman, is now an original moralist in England. That's what he's done to me.
That sounds like one of his jokes.
You may call it a joke, but it's put the lid on me proper. The old millionaire left me £4,000 a year ago in his blooming will. Tell me, who asked him to make a gentleman out of me? I was happy.
Alfie, it's not so bad.
I was free, being the poor dustman. A year ago, I hadn't any relation in the world, except for one or two who wouldn't speak to me. But now, I have a 50. Ooh, I have to live for others and not for myself. Blast the middle-class morality.
Come on, Alfie. Another couple of hours. We have to be at church.
Church? Father?
Yeah, church. The deepest cut of all, my girl. Why do you think I'm dressed up like a ruddy pearl bearer? Your stepmother wants to marry me. Now I'm respectable. She wants to be respectable.
Oh, Father.
Eliza, sent you back, has he? First, he shoves me into the middle class and then chucks you out for me to support you. It's all a part of his plan. Well, Eliza, listen to me and listen tight. Don't you come back home to me. You can stand on your own two feet. You're a lady now. You can do it. You're a lady now.
I'm a lady now.
Here, Eliza, would you like to come and see me getting married this morning? St. George, Hanover Square, 10 o'clock. I wouldn't advise it, but you're welcome.
No, thank you, Father.
Oh, no, that's fine. Are you all finished here, Eliza?
Yes, Father. I'm all finished. I'm all finished here.
Pickering! Pickering! Did even say when to send her clothes?
I told you, sir. She took them all with her.
Pickering!
What's the matter?
Here's the confounded thing. Eliza's bolted.
Bolted?
Bolted. Last night, Mrs. Pierce let her go without telling me a thing about it.
Well, dashed.
What am I to do? I got tea this morning instead of coffee. I don't know where anything is. I don't know what my appointments are.
Well, I'm sure Eliza would know.
Of course she knows, but she's gone.
Did either of you gentlemen frighten her last night?
No. We hardly ever spoke a word to her yesterday. You were there. Did you bully her after I went to bed?
Quite the opposite. She screamed at me. I never gave her the slightest provocation.
Well, I don't understand. I'm dashed.
Oh, Pickering, for God's sake, stop being dashed and do something about
what?
It.
What?
Well, phone the police. What are they there for in heaven's name?
Miss Higgins, you can't just give her name to the police as if she were a thief or a lost umbrella.
Why not? I paid £5 for her. What in all of heaven could have prompted her to go after such a triumph at the ball?
Hello, Scotland Yard, please.
Oh, I do hope you find her, Colonel Pickering. Mr. Higgins will miss her.
Blast Miss Higgins. I'll miss her.
I already miss her. Oh, Eliza, where are you?
I got my ticket for the long way around. And I'm leaving tomorrow, what you say? When I'm gone, when I'm gone. You're gonna miss me when I'm gone. You're gonna miss me by my head. You're gonna miss me everywhere, oh. You're gonna miss me when I'm gone. When I'm gone, when I'm gone. You're gonna miss me when I'm gone. You're gonna miss me by my walk. You're gonna miss me by my talk, oh. I got my ticket for the long way round. The one with the prettiest of views. It's got mountains, it's got rivers, it's got lights, give you shivers, but it sure would be prettier with you. When I'm gone, when I'm gone. You're gonna miss me when I'm gone. You're gonna miss me by my walk. You're gonna miss me by my talk. Oh.
Word.
They never petted you or admired you or told you how splendid you've been?
Not a word. They just sat there congratulating each other on how marvelous they'd been. The next moment, how glad they were it was all over and what a bore it had all been.
That's simply appalling.
How is my mother in?
What's that?
Henry, I knew it wouldn't be too long. Now remember, you not only danced with the prince last night, but you behaved like a true princess.
Mother, mother, the most confounded thing, do you? You?
Good afternoon, Professor Higgins. Are you quite well?
Am I?
Of course you are. You are never ill. Would you care for some tea?
Don't you dare try that game on me. I taught it to you. Now stop being a fool and come home. You've caused me enough trouble for one morning.
Very well put indeed, Henry. No woman could resist such an invitation.
How did this baggage get here in the first place?
Baggage? Eliza came to see me this morning, and I was delighted to have her. Now, if you don't promise to behave, be respectful towards Eliza, I must ask you to leave.
You mean to say I'm to put on my Sunday manners for this thing that I created out of squashed cabbage leaves of Covent Garden?
That's precisely what I mean. Dear Eliza, how ever did you learn good manners with my son around?
It was very difficult. I should not have known how ladies and gentlemen behave if it weren't for Colonel Pickering. He always showed me what he thought of me and that I was something better than a common flower girl. You see, Mrs. Higgins, apart from the things one can pick up, the difference between a lady and a flower girl is not how she behaves, but how she is treated. I shall always be a flower girl to Mr. Higgins because he has always treated me as one and always will.
Henry, don't grind your teeth.
The bishop is here, madam. Shall I send him into the garden?
I shall see him in the library. Eliza, if my son starts bringing things, I give you full permission to have him evicted. And Henry, I suggest you stick to two subjects, the weather and your health.
Well, you've had a bit of your own buck, as you call it. Now, have you had enough and are you going to come home, or do you want more?
You want me back to put up with your tempers and fetch and carry for you?
I didn't say I wanted you back at all.
Oh, indeed. Then what are we talking about?
Well, about you, not about me. If you decide to come back, you'll be treated as you've always been treated. I can't change my nature. I don't intend to change my nature. My manners are exactly the same as Colonel Pickering's.
That's not true. He treats a flower girl as if she were a duchess.
Well, I treat the duchess as if she were a flower girl.
Oh, I see. The same to everyone.
Just so. You see, the great secret, Eliza, is not a question of good manners or bad manners or any particular sort of manners, but having the same manner for all human beings. The question is not whether I've ever treated you rudely, but whether you've ever heard me treat anyone else better.
But I can get along without you.
I know you can. I told you, you could. You've never wondered, I suppose, if I could get along without you. And so I can, without you or any other soul on earth. I shall miss you, Eliza.
Well, you have my voice on your gramophone. You can turn it on when you feel lonely without me. It has no feelings to hurt.
All I want is a room somewhere far away from the cold night air, with one enormous chair of wood. It'd be lovely. Oh, Eliza, I miss you.
Well, I ain't come here to ask for any compliment, and my money's not good enough. I can go elsewhere.
Good enough for what?
Good enough for you. Now you know, don't you? I've come to have my lessons, I am, and to pay for them too. Make no mistake.
Eliza?
I want to be a lady in a flower shop, instead of selling flowers at the corner of Tottenham Court Road. But they won't take me, unless I can talk more genteel. Yesterday, he said he could teach me. Well, here I am.
Eliza, you came back?
It's the gramophone, Miss Higgins. You had recorded earlier.
I'll switch it off.
No, don't switch it off. I want to hear Liza's voice.
I won't give more than a shilling. Take it or leave it.
It's almost irresistible. She's so low, so horribly dirty. I'll take it. I'll make a duchess of this rocket wave.
It's before I come, I did.
Eliza!
Eliza? You came. I missed you. I mean, how rude and disrespectful I've been to you. If only you could fathom the depth of my heart.
Well, and what do you intend to say?
I thought I turned you into a sophisticated lady. It was you who changed me into a human being. A person with emotions, sense, and sensibility. You were never a rugged waif. You were always a queen. A queen with a compassionate and loving heart. The best lady in all England.
Nothing matters more than goodness of heart. What a wonderful transformation of hearts and souls. Nothing is ever too late to change. Let all life flourish. Let all humans thrive. Yes, here's to good health and staying alive.
Somebody help me. I'm sure all of you enjoyed this colorful evening of music and dance. On behalf of every student, I, Pranav Raju, the head boy of PG Garodia School ICSE, would like to extend my warm gratitude towards our trustee, Mr. Mahesh Garodia, and our managing trustee, Mr. Nishant Garodia, who have indeed been a pillar of support for each one of us. I thank our principal ma'am, Ms. Mithali Rudra, who is the backbone of our school. I also thank our headmistress, Ms. Sujata Badian, for the efforts taken by her in making this event a grand one. A big round of applause to all the teachers who groomed the actors and the choir. We are indeed thankful to our choreographers, Tidas, who put each and every child on their toes. A special mention to the costume suppliers, Prakruti Fancy Dresses and Classic Dresswala, who arranged for such vibrant costumes and transformed the students into real performers. A big thanks to GFX lighting team and Rani decorators, who indeed uplifted the stage to a real theatre. We are indeed thankful to the parent of Arav Shethia from 7B and the parent of Ishan Dati from 7B, who arranged for a car as a special prop during the play. Our sincere thanks to the canteen staff who helped to keep our energy levels high. Give a big hand to the non-teaching staff as well, without whom this event would not have been possible. A special mention to all the volunteers who worked hard in coordinating this event. I also thank all our parents and PTA members who supported their children and the school right from the practice sessions to this final show. Lastly, kudos to all the students who put in their level best in making this event a grand success. Now, I request everyone to stand in attention for the school anthem. Let us render the school anthem together.
There is
Now, I request everyone to remain in attention for the national anthem. I hand over the mic to Rajeshri ma'am, who will announce the dispersal.